Okay, now we're going to talk a little bit about the sums of geometric series. So a sequence of that's growing geometrically, meaning by a multiplication as opposed to addition, finding the sum of an infinite geometric series. Normally, when we find the sum of a geometric series, we're finding a what's called a partial sum, because we can't find the sum of something that's infinitely large most of the time. So we find what's called a partial sum, which is just the first n terms of the series. It might be the first 12 terms, might be the first 8,000 terms, but we usually can't find it. However, with a geometric series, oftentimes we can find the sum because the series is what converges on a value, which means it approaches a certain value but never actually gets there. So if the series converges towards some value, we can find the sum of the series. Now, the series won't actually equal that sum until it adds up all of its infinite terms. And as you know, you can't add infinite terms. So in reality, this series is approaching this value and getting closer and closer and closer and closer to this value forever, but actually never reaching that. So let's look at this infinite geometric series. We know it's infinite because we've got our ellipses out here, right, showing that it goes on forever. We know it's a series because we are adding all the terms. And we know it's geometric because we're cutting every term in half. We are multiplying by one half every time, right? We're doubling the denominator or cutting the value in half. So if we were to find the first five partial sums, meaning sum number one is the first term, sum number two is the first and second term, sum number three is the first, second, and third term, etc. If we were to find the first five partial sums, so partial sum one, partial sum two, partial sum three, four, and five, just by adding up the first five terms, first four terms, first three terms, etc., and then graph those. So we're going to make a graph that has one, two, three, four and five for the first, second, third, fourth, and fifth partial sums, and the y-axis is going to be these values. We get a graph that looks something like this. And you can see it's quickly, at the beginning, very quickly approaching a limit of one. But as we get farther and farther down the x-axis, the amount we grow each time shrinks, right? We grew very little here compared to the first sum where we grew by 0.5. So as it continues to get as n as the number of terms continues to get larger, we're getting closer and closer and closer to one, but we're never actually going to get there. So if you take all of these numbers, the next one will be 1/64, then 1/128, then 1/256, and then 1/512, and you keep adding those together, you get closer and closer and closer to a value of one. Even though you add forever, it'll never get bigger than one. So this is what's called a convergent geometric series. Some geometric series do just get bigger and bigger forever. If we multiply by two every time, for example, that thing's just going to take off exponentially, right? But and this is still exponential, but it's not diverging, meaning it's not just taking off forever. So to find the sum of an infinite geometric series, we're going to use this formula. So you're going to want to make sure this is in your notes right now. A sub 1 is the first term. Common ratio is what we're multiplying by every time, so those are the only two things we're going to need. Now, this only works if the absolute value of our common ratio is less than 1. If the absolute value of the ratio is greater than 1, meaning like negative 2 or positive 7, then it's going to have no sum and it would be divergent or diverging, meaning it's just taking off. Well, that's not quotation marks. It's just exploding to either positive or negative infinity. But if r is less than 1, or the absolute value of r is less than 1, then it will converge. So make sure you have this in your notes. Pause if you're not done. I'm going to move on. So, first step is going to be to determine whether or not these series have sums or not. So we need to identify the r value. We're looking to see if r, more specifically the absolute value of r, is less than 1 or not. So r in this case is 0.7. That is less than 1. Okay. So this one's going to be yes. B, let's see, multiplying by 3 every time. It seems to work. So r is 3. That's not bigger than 1. So this does not have a sum. Now this one's alternating between positive and negative, which means that r has to be a negative value, so that when I multiply a positive number, I get a negative. Then when I multiply this negative number by my negative r, I go back to positive, and that repeats, so it's obviously going to be negative. To go from 1 to 3/4, we are multiplying by 3/4. And if I do that again, 3 times 3 is 9, and 4 times 4 is 16. 9 times 3 is 27, 16 times 4 is 64. So this is our r value. It is the absolute value of r is 3/4, which is less than 1. So this is also yes. So A and C will have sums, B will not. Okay, so now let's do that. We're going to find the sums for part A and part C. We're going to need that formula again. So here it is in the top right. First term over 1 minus the common ratio. So to find the first term, we just need to plug in 1 for I. So I'm going to have 3 times 0.7 to the 1 minus 1. Well, that's 3 times 0.7 to the 0. So that's 3 times 1. So that's 3. So the sum is equal to 3 over 1 minus, what did we say our R value was? It's this guy, right? The 0.7. So our sum is 3 over 0.3. You can do that on a calculator if you want, but 3 divided by 0.3 is 10. So the sum of this guy is going to get closer and closer and closer to 10 as I keep adding more terms. It will never actually equal 10 unless I add every single term in this infinitely long series. You can't add infinitely many terms, so it'll never actually reach 10. Okay, let's do the other one. This is part C. We said that R was a negative 3/4. We can see that a sub 1 is 1 because that's the first term. So the sum is 1 over 1 minus, notice there's a minus here. R is negative, so that's going to be another 1, 3/4. So we could say that's 1 over 1 plus 0.75. 3 over 4 is 0.75. I'm subtracting a negative, so I'm really adding. So this is 1 over 1.75. If you run that through a calculator, 1 divided by 1.75 comes out to be 0.5714. If you leave it as a fraction, it's going to be 4/7. Either one of these is fine. So that's the sum that this series will approach as you keep adding more and more terms, 4 over 7 or 0.5714. Okay. Short video today. That's it. Homework is what's coming up next. Good luck. Let me know if you have any questions.